Hey, how's it going, everyone? I'm White Pointer, and since my previous video about how the Super Game Boy enhanced Game Boy games turned out to be pretty popular, I decided to do a natural follow-up video about the other way Nintendo colored original Game Boy games, and that was with the Game Boy Color. Launched in 1998, which was 9 years after the original Game Boy hit the market, it wasn't a giant leap into a new generation, but rather an incremental update on the design. It was fully backwards compatible with every original Game Boy game and was able to enhance them with color. However, the way it did this was different to how the Super Game Boy did it, so let's take a detailed look to see how it all worked. Before I go any further, I want to acknowledge that Modern Vintage Gamer did a video a while back that explained how the GBC's graphics worked, and I'd highly suggest you check that out if you're unfamiliar with it. However, he only really briefly touched on the subject of enhancing standard Game Boy games, so that's what the purpose of this video is, but that video is still good to watch if you need an overview. So, as I mentioned, the Game Boy Color was basically an update on the original Game Boy hardware. It had the same CPU, but clocked twice as fast at 8.39 MHz. To maintain backwards compatibility though, when playing original Game Boy games it could slow down to the correct speed of 4.19 MHz, so it didn't have the problem of games running too fast like the Model 1 Super Game Boy did. The RAM was upgraded from 8 KB of work RAM and 8 KB of VRAM to 32 KB of work RAM and 16 KB of VRAM. The screen was updated from a monochrome LCD to a full colour TFT, and the screen size was actually a bit smaller but maintained the same resolution of 160 by 144. That's about it, everything else was more or less the same or close enough. Overall, the differences between them were minor enough that even Nintendo groups them together as a singular platform. While it worked with every original Game Boy game, the same couldn't be said the other way around. Some GBC games worked in the original, which usually had black cartridges, but other games that required the better hardware, usually with clear cartridges, could not, and specifically needed to run on the Game Boy Color. So just to make sure I'm clear about this video, I'm not covering either of these. I'm only specifically talking about how the GBC enhanced original Game Boy games, which usually had grey cartridges. If you watched my video about the Super Game Boy and how it coloured Game Boy games, you might have been wondering if those SGB enhanced games were automatically coloured out of the box in the GBC. And the short answer to that is no, they weren't, because the two devices coloured the games in different ways. But since you clicked on this video, I'm guessing you want to know the long answer, right? Okay, let's dive in and find out exactly what's going on. As I explained in my previous video, the Super Game Boy drew all of the Game Boy's layers separately, just like a real Game Boy did, but then needed to render that to the TV screen through the Super Nintendo somehow. It did this by drawing the complete Game Boy image to a single Super Nintendo background layer, which freed up the other layers for the border and the customization tools. What this meant though was that, as far as the Super Nintendo was concerned, the Game Boy's image was effectively flattened into a single layer, so the console could not differentiate between Game Boy sprites and backgrounds, it just saw it as a single image. When it applied a color palette, it would be applied to both sprites and backgrounds together. The only way you could get more colors on the screen was to use individually colored tiles, which only really worked on static screens or static parts of the screen like a HUD. However, because the Game Boy Color didn't need to go through a Super Nintendo to draw the image to the screen, because it was just a beefier Game Boy, it worked exactly the same as an original Game Boy, drawing each layer to the screen separately. So, it could tell the difference between backgrounds and sprites. Now, even though the Game Boy only had a 2-bit monochrome display, resulting in 4 shades of green, or grey if you prefer, it did actually have 3 separate color palettes, one for the backgrounds and 2 for sprites, or objects as they were also sometimes called. They all had the same 4 shades, mind you, but they did technically use separate palettes. This concept wasn't unusual, it was obviously so developers could have a different palette for the sprites and backgrounds. But why would you even need that with only 4 colours? Why would it matter? Even though there were only 4 colours, you can make a palette consist of 3, 2, or even just 1 colour if you really wanted to, and you often didn't want that affecting everything on the screen. You could also potentially change the color palette of sprites without affecting the background, or vice versa, for example making a flashing effect like how when Mega Man charges his shot. This is created by using a quick alternating palette swap, but in this case you would only want this to apply to the sprite, not the entire screen. There's two sprite palettes, as sometimes you want to separate different sprites. As when Mega Man flashes, you don't want all the enemy sprites flashing too, so the enemies in this case are set up to use a different palette. This second sprite palette was also sometimes used to distinguish between player 1 and player 2 in fighting games like Killer Instinct. So the Game Boy Color could differentiate between sprites and backgrounds, and had full access to these three palettes. As a result, unlike the Super Game Boy, it could set the sprites and backgrounds to use a different palette of four colors, giving original Game Boy games at least the capability of displaying up to 10 colors on screen at once. Because remember, one color in each sprite palette was assigned to be transparent. However, because the second sprite palette was used pretty rarely, and also because there were often duplicate colors across palettes, I don't believe any games actually hit that maximum number. In a similar way to how the Super Game Boy assigned default palettes to some older, non-enhanced games, the GBC could detect when specific games were inserted on startup and automatically assign colors to the background and object palettes. I'll leave a link in the description to a full list of different palettes that could be applied and examples of games for each if you're interested. In many cases, games were just set up to use one palette for the background and then have both sprite palettes use basically the same colors. It did try to make the second sprite palette unique in some games, but it was often barely noticeable simply because that palette wasn't used much by the original game. Link's Awakening, for example, not the DX version, but the original version, displays all sprites in this green palette, but there's also a blue palette which is only really used for some pickups like hearts and rupees, so you almost never see it. Warrior Land is in the same boat. You only really see that second sprite palette in use for these heart pickups you can collect, making them flash red and blue. You might not even notice it unless you're specifically looking for it. It also briefly uses it just after Wario gets hit. Metroid 2 only uses it to make Samus or an enemy flash green to indicate when they take damage, and to make health refills, ammo refills, and some pickups also flash green. The three Donkey Kong Land games all have these pretty bright colors in the second object palette, but they might as well not even be there. The third game only seems to use it on these very specific rare enemies that only appear in three levels. And the first two games don't even do that, as they only seem to be used for stuff like these destructible rocks, or these flashing arrows on the map screens. One game that did make noticeable use of that second object palette though was Super Mario Land 2, the six golden coins, with some enemies using a distinctive blue palette instead of the orange one used by Mario and other enemies. Magnetic Soccer, which if you can't tell is basically a video game version of foosball, makes decent use of the two different object palettes to display the two teams in two different colours, which are both different to the background. Baseball, yeah, it's just called Baseball, which I showed a clip of earlier, also utilises each palette quite well to colour the playing field and both of the teams. Top Rank Tennis is a really good example and looks pretty nice, using different palettes of colours for the court, player character and opponent. But examples like these are pretty rare. They could only play the cards they were dealt, so it's a bit of a pity that so few original Game Boy games made good use of that second sprite palette. Some games also had pretty weird setups, such as Street Fighter 2. In this case, the characters are not actually sprites, as you might expect them to be, they are part of the background, and use the background color palette. Sprites are instead only used for projectile attacks, hit indicators, and some various elements such as some text that overlays on the screen. This really odd approach means that the Game Boy Color simply can't color these characters with a different palette to the background, no matter how hard it tries. Oh, you might have noticed that second object palette with green in it. You want to know where that's used? Prepare yourself, here it is! Yep, this is the only place in the entire game it's used, for this green dot on the main menu. Well done, Capcom. Aside from strange examples like that, fighting games are one genre that did tend to make use of the second object palette, and King of Fighters 95 on the GBC actually looks reasonably close to the Super Game Boy's colours, albeit getting there a different way. The backgrounds are obviously a bit different, but the characters and HUDs look extremely similar. Despite the differences in how the two devices colored original Game Boy games, one game that did actually look really comparable between the GBC and SGB when it was enhanced might seem like an unlikely one. Game & Watch Gallery, the first game in the series specifically. This is a compilation of four Game & Watch games that each have a modern mode and a classic mode. Both modes for each game are quite remarkably similar when played on the two devices that could apply color to these games. It's not a perfect match, but it's about as close as you can reasonably expect. You could be forgiven for getting the two platforms confused. The original Pokemon games are an interesting case when played on the Game Boy Color, as the device assigns a different set of palettes based on what version you're playing. Pokemon Red has a red tint to the background, Pokemon Blue has a blue tint to the background, and Pocket Monsters Midori has a green tint to the background. None of them really made use of the second object palette, and didn't add any extra color to the battle screens like the Super Game Boy did, but it's better than nothing. The Pikachu edition though was different depending on the region. The Japanese version, called Pocket Monsters Pikachu, is very similar to the original games and has palettes assigned to color everything in red, yellow, and black to match Pikachu's colors. It makes sense. However, the international version, called Pokemon Yellow Version Special Pikachu Edition, was actually upgraded to be a full Game Boy Color game that uses way more colors with dynamic palettes that would change as you played, including full color battle screens. The box art doesn't indicate it's a Game Boy Color game, nor does it have a black cartridge, although it was bundled with the Game Boy Color in some regions. So I think that actually makes it the only original Game Boy game that was specifically enhanced for the Game Boy Color. What do you think? Is this actually a Game Boy game that's being augmented for the Game Boy Color, or is this simply just a black cartridge game that was mislabeled? I'd love to know your thoughts in the comments. Ultimately, it ends up looking almost identical to the Super Game Boy. And if it is indeed an upgraded Game Boy game, it's pretty impressive that they actually took the time to enhance the game for both devices, given the differences in how they worked. It didn't end there though. Even if a game wasn't one that the Game Boy Color could recognize and automatically set color palettes to, it could, in fact, still breed some color into it. If it didn't recognize it, it seemed to automatically default to a set of palettes that made the background blue and green, and the sprites pink and brown. An odd thing about that default coloring though is that it sometimes wasn't consistent with the same games across different regions. One example of this is Mystic Quest, which is the PAL region version of Final Fantasy Adventure, the first game in the Mana series. Not to be confused with Final Fantasy Mystic Quest on the Super Nintendo, which was a completely different game. For some reason, the Game Boy Color doesn't seem to have Final Fantasy Adventure in North America in its internal database, so it assigns the same pink colors for both sprite palettes and blue and green for the background. But for Mystic Quest in Europe, it does seem to recognize it, and assigns pink for the sprite palette used by the player character, and blue for the one used by NPCs and enemies, making them stand out more, while also coloring the background a little differently too. I'm really not too sure what the reason for this difference is. That's not the only game this applies to though, as some of the Mega Man games, like Mega Man 3, also do the same thing. It assigns the same colours to both sprite palettes in the North American version, making both Mega Man and enemies pink, while assigning different colours to the sprite palettes in the European version, making Mega Man blue and the enemies green. The backgrounds are also assigned different palettes. So it appears that the GBC can't match the ROM header of the North American version in its internal database, but can match the European version, despite being exactly the same game otherwise. It truly is quite peculiar. However, if you didn't like the default colors, you could manually choose from some inbuilt palettes by pressing specific button combinations on the Game Boy Color logo screen. The same page I mentioned earlier, which is linked in the description, also lists the different button combinations and what they did. In total, there were 12 different predefined sets of palettes that could be chosen manually in this way, and could be applied to any original Game Boy games, overriding any automatic setting if the game had one. It wasn't anywhere near as customizable as the Super Game Boy was, but it was nice to have the option. Oddly enough, even though they were recognized by the GBC and had palettes assigned to them, some games still only displayed in four colors. An example of this is Mario's Picross. Yes, thank you to those comments in my previous video that pointed out to me that it's pronounced Picross, not Picross. Not that it would have made much of a difference in most cases, but at least you could still get a few more colors by using the manual selection. Yeah, okay, maybe using only four colors was a good thing. It goes without saying that everything I've spoken about here only applies to enhancing original Game Boy games on the Game Boy Color. Games that were specifically built for the Game Boy Color, like Perfect Dark, were obviously more advanced and could display way more colors than what we've just looked at, but for this video I only wanted to focus on how it colorized original Game Boy games. So that's why I didn't look at games like Pokemon Gold and Silver, or even Game & Watch Gallery 2 and 3, or some of the other GBC black cartridge games that I mentioned in my Super Game Boy video, like FIFA 2000 or Beatmania GB. These were not original Game Boy games that were coloured when played on the Game Boy Color, but were instead developed as Game Boy Color games that were backwards compatible with the older hardware, and also included enhancements for the Super Game Boy. Who knows, if enough people are interested, I might consider doing a video that looks at these games more closely in the future. Oh, by the way, you might have noticed that I finally upgraded my microphone, so let me know in the comments what you think about the audio quality. Also, don't forget that I've written a book, Secrets of Video Game Consoles, where I go into all kinds of facts and trivia about video game consoles, ranging from the Magnavox Odyssey to the Nintendo Switch, and I'll leave some links in the description where you can buy it if you're interested. Did you have a favourite Game Boy game that you played on the Game Boy Color? What did you think about the Game Boy Color in general and how it worked with Game Boy games? Drop a comment and let me know. I'll leave this video there, so give me a thumbs up if you liked it, it really helps a lot, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with my content. Thanks for watching, and see you next time!